Welcome back. With this short lecture, I'd like to introduce the discipline of design, or more specifically, landscape architecture. You see the outline here. All humans are depending on the use of tools ranging from a house to clothes and stoves and other household utensils, and that's why we are surrounded by artifacts. From a rather moderate amount of stuff in Mali and Mongolia, as you can see, to a stunning amount of artifacts in rich countries like Japan and the USA. Every man-made thing in the world has a shape, a spatial form in which it is handmade or manufactured. Artifacts are evolving, becoming better and better for their intended use. Take such a simple thing as a spoon that has been around for perhaps 10,000 years. First crafted, made from wood, with the distinct disadvantage of a taste memory. Copper and iron, next step in evolution, can be mass manufactured, but also influence taste. Silver, as an almost inert material, does better, but is way too expensive for the mass public. Finally, in the 40s of the last century, stainless steel brings the best of both worlds. Less expensive and no taste influence at all. Design plays a role in the later stages of this evolution of the spoon giving form in shaping shape, so to say. The iPhone and the John Deere tractor both are the products of intense cooperation between technicians and designers to shape these artifacts. Mostly, the role of the designer is servant and anonymous, and mostly the designing process is let's form follow function. Sometimes the role is more prominent, like how Jony Ive helped to shape the brand of Apple by sharp designs. He became a celebrity, even a knight, Sir Jonathan Ives, and went beyond form follows function. He was obsessed, fascinated with making things as thin as possible, like the famous wafer, thin but very vulnerable butterfly keyboard he designed, and removing the MagSafe power connector, the HDMI port, and the SD card reader from the MacBook Air. So design might also influence even command technique. I can see some learners asking themselves, are we in the right edX course? Where is all this leading? But these were, I assure you, functional stepping stones to ask ourselves the question whether landscapes can be designed. This Arcadian picture shows the Dutch peat landscape, Waterland, just north of Amsterdam. The naked eye would take it for a nature reserve, but you are looking at the resultant of a 600 year of reclamation history, starting with vast moorland like this one. Reclaiming moorland was done by digging ditches and draining the bog that, once free from the water, would oxidize and give away its minerals and other nutrients for arable farming. This period of soil fertility will last until the oxidized soil subsides, reaches the water table again, and needs to be drained deeper. This process was reinforced by embankments, later wind-driven drainage, and centuries later mechanical drainage. The west of the Netherlands lost some 6 meters of bog, and we pumped ourselves way below sea level. And this is what a co-production between nature and man looks like from the satellite. A layer that is not available on Google Earth is the intricate system of ditches, canals, sluices, locks, water table regulations and pumps that we need to control the water levels for agriculture and for the built environment with its wooden foundation. So this landscape is, well, you could say, an artifact in a way. We need this giant prothesis to work, farm, and live below the sea level. It is the resultant of reclamation. It is engineered, but it is not designed. A co-production between nature and man. But the map reveals yet another layer in the landscape. I want to draw your attention to these little polders, reclaimed land from lakes that emerged after peat cutting. This famous 1622 map, boasting the reclamation polders of North Holland, you will recognize them in the map right under. I show this map because it is an example that landscape architecture and civil engineering share a mutual ancestor. These polders were designed by the first generation of surveyors in Holland. In their very practical education, there was no distinction between the technical and the architectonic component. In other words, these surveyors made both technically sound and aesthetic, satisfying designs. That's possibly why the Beemster, the large polder you see on the right top, was proclaimed UNESCO World Heritage a couple of years ago. It is a fine example of a work before the fall of labor division, where civil engineering and design were as one. In the 20th century, the organically evolved reclamation landscapes and the designed plant landscapes merge in the post-war radical modernization and upscaling of the Dutch landscape to make it suitable for modern agriculture. Landscape architects employed within the state helped to shape these new production landscapes. And well, all in all, the program was the biggest project ever undertaken in the Netherlands. Dikes and levees were solidly in the engineering domain until strengthening them in the late 20th century spurred a wave of protests of inhabitants. Improving scour, seepage, and piping characteristics led to not very much higher, but much broader dike profiles that proved intrusive for the existing landscape and locally was said to ruin the river landscape. In this cross-section, you can compare the existing dike, the existing river dike, with the new, broader technical profile. These protests, in a way, brought back together engineering and design that have been separated sectoral silos for decades. Landscape architects were invited to advise Rijkswaterstaat that thought to have done everything possible to smother the protests with their smart engineering approach. You can see that in the top right. This approach consisted of comprehensive analysis of cultural history, cultural, historic, and ecological values of the existing situation, rate them on a national and an international scale, and in the design, try to spare the highest rated elements. This running with the hare and hunt with the hounds in trying to steer the enormous profile clear of cultural heritage sites and then steering the other way to spare a natural area outside the dike resulted in a haphazard dike profile loaded with ad hoc solutions for local problems, as you can see top right. The core of the advice was that Rijkswaterstaat seemed to have forsaken their cultural task in making self-confident, beautiful dikes instead of a string of compromises. The team, the advisory team, offered a smart design toolbox with standard solutions and rules of engagement. I give you an example. Cultural heritage has always priority when it comes to triage because it's literally irreplaceable. And with well-chosen methods, natural values can be reconstructed in a dynamic biome as a river floodplain. The advice itself was a toolbox of rules of how to deal with the relationship of the strengthened dike and the receiving landscape. The changes that were advised could all be done within the technical profile of the dike, as you can see. A fixed format for the support shoulder, and one of the other most interesting recommendations was to sculpt a tapered top. The upper part of the embankment is just a bit steeper than the lower part, making the dike seem more slender. That is because you do not see the upper part of the embankment as well while driving on the dike. This modest intervention recreates the sensation, so to speak, as if you are floating over the landscape. That magic feeling the original dike gave to bicyclists and bikers. The designed new profile is a prime example of the cooperation between engineers and designers and show the potential of bringing the two silos together again. But the role of designers is not restricted to helping to shape the new infrastructure, the new dikes. If we took a closer look at the 9 ways to safety in the building blocks you worked with the last 2 weeks, you'll observe that only enhancing the dikes, lowering the summer bed of the river, and lowering the groins can be done within the sectoral domain of the water board, where they own the land. For all the other 6 potential measures, they have to consult all kinds of other landowners, from farmers to municipalities and nature conservationists. The water board has to come out of their comfort zone and enter the field of spatial planning, and there design can play a mediating role. To give that process a factor, a compass, spatial quality was introduced as the second main goal after water safety of the whole program. This introduces a possible tension between the scientific approach of the engineers and the subjective world of quality. As an interface between the matter-of-fact world and the matters-of-concern world of the designers, a definition or at least a description is necessary of spatial or landscape quality with projects of this scale. With a wink to Vitruvius, the Roman architect and engineer, indeed this is again before the fall of labor division, who in his 10 books on architecture defines the quality of a building as the elegant balance between usefulness, solidity and beauty, this definition of landscape quality of the project was pragmatically defined as the elegant combination of hydraulic efficiency, how to achieve the desired hydraulic effect with minimal means, ecological robustness, how the river dynamics can support habitat quality, and aesthetic meaning, how to make a meaningful contribution to the river landscape while making use of a design idiom characteristic of the river. The aerial photo, by the way, shows the Noordwaard, quite close to Rotterdam and the biggest of the 32 projects in the Dutch Room for the River program. And this is the integral plan of the Noordwaard, bringing together hydraulics, ecology, agriculture, heritage and leisure aspects. The influx opening, an according to plan lower dike segment in the north of the polder, makes the Noordwaard a powerful instrument in lowering the mean high water table in the area. The bottom row shows how the polder reacts on different water tables, from completely dry to completely flooded. The agricultural cores, light yellow on the map, are always dry and usable except for a 100-200 years event. And on the right, in the gray boxes, you see how the designer tuned the landscape to the new direction of the outflowing water in case of high discharges. Plans like this are not made in a vacuum, but in close contact with specialists from various disciplines. The designer and the project manager use the design phase for participation and co-creation. The design map itself is always a conversation piece. This is the planning overview of the Munnikenland project. Here, making a new dike to meet the planned high water inundation is combined with nature development and the accessibility of an old castle, Slot Loevestein, that played an important role in Dutch history and is now a popular heritage site. These are combined. Design played a considerable role in the whole program and facilitated timely completion of the program by broader public support. And maybe counterintuitively, design also helped to stay within the budget because of the sober definition of landscape quality, and that stopped extravagances short. Like every week, we end this introduction with future trends in the discipline at hand. That is, of course, this week, designing. I want to highlight just one trend, a trend that is important in the context of our MOOC. The emerging role design plays as an instrument for future research. While prognosis and modeling may try to predict the future, design has the freedom to speculate on the future, as you can see here, and take in the aspect of the free will. And here you see an animated floor projection that shows how, with Chinese building speeds, using the North Sea as a trump card, the North Sea countries by 2050 can harvest 90% of their electricity demand from offshore wind. The animation was shown to the European ministers of energy during the Dutch presidency and helped forging a new cooperation deal between the North Sea countries. So speculations like this, research by design like this, can help to shape reality, to make it, well, an accomplished fiction, so to say. The ancestor of the Room for the River program was the product of research by design too. The winning entry of a competition of future visions for our river landscape was won by Plan Ooievaar in 1985. The plan speculated on how both ecology and agricultural economy can be boosted in the river area. This typical panorama of the Dutch landscape, the ecological component of the plan pivoted around buying out farmers that in the past constructed these little summer dikes to protect the continuity in grazing, even with most high waters. By removing these levees, allowing the river dynamics and free space on a larger area and for longer periods of time, erosion, sedimentation, and germinating of biota and everything not being grazed away by intensive agricultural use would result in the return of river forest in Holland. That was the promise of the plan. The first summer levee was opened in 1989. And this is the same terrain after 30 years and after year-round grazing was introduced. Ooievaar, translated into English as stalk, kept its promise. The icon of the plan, the black stalk, the forest stalk, returned a couple of years ago after 3 centuries of absence. One of the tools was compensating the increased resistance to the water flow from the new forest by strategic excavation, giving out permits for pebble, clay, and sand companies. This active way to treat and mold the riverbed has been very successful. By now, some 8,000 hectares of this toolbox plan has been executed. This research by design plan by a multidisciplinary team of designers, ecologists, river historians, and river managers has been the incubator of the Room for the River philosophy. Thank you for watching.